Stephen Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today, a production of the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today we'll be talking about SAT optional schools. Aaron Basco is Director of Admissions at Salisbury University in Maryland. Under Aaron's guidance, Salisbury has become a test optional school for students with a 3.5 GPA or higher. Aaron's team of 14 communicates with over 10,000 applicants per year. Bob Schaefer is Public Education Director of FairTest, the National Center for Fair and Open Testing. FairTest works to end misuses of standardized testing, including the SAT and ACT. Bob is co-author of Standing Up to the SAT and contributor to SAT Wars. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you very much.
Well, thanks again for coming on. If we can start, Bob, maybe with you, is what is the SAT? What does it stand for? What does it measure?
The SAT, formerly called the Scholastic Aptitude Test, is a measure pretty much of how well you take the SAT and other standardized tests. Its owners claim that it's a predictor of first-year college grades, not a very meaningful outcome, and it doesn't predict it very well. In terms of high college graduation, what really matters, the SAT is a weaker predictor than our high school grades, and it's a predictor that is filled with many biases, susceptibility to coaching, and weak prediction that make it not a very useful tool.
And Aaron, at Salisbury, you use the SATs sometimes, but not other times. Is that right?
Correct. When we're looking at students, obviously, we want to get a holistic review of a student and see what they can bring to the institution. But the first thing that we're going to look at, obviously, is the academic background that the student has, what courses that they've chosen, and the grades that they've had in that. And we consider a standardized test score as a piece of that academic credential that a student might bring. But at the same time, we are actually the only public institution in the state of Maryland that has a test optional policy, which allows students with a 3.5 or higher to choose whether or not they would like to submit their scores. And what we have found over the years is that we work with a good number of students who have great performance in the classroom, but when it comes to their test scores, it doesn't really quite do them justice. And we really want to work with those students because we know that their background indicates they're going to be successful in a rigorous environment.
But my understanding is that you also require the SAT or ACT for students who are going for certain scholarships.
Well, we recommend that students give their scores for scholarship consideration if they want full consideration to all scholarships. And the reason that we do that, usually universities, colleges and universities, when they're giving out scholarship money, when they're looking at their financial aid models and saying, okay, we have a certain amount of funding that we can give to students, and they look at scholarships, they're using scholarships as a way to attract the most competitive candidates. And in most cases, those most competitive candidates that will help their profile include not only a strong academic background in terms of classes, but also often have top scores. So oftentimes, those students will be the first ones that they look at for scholarships. But having said that, we have students every year who receive scholarships from us that utilize our test optional policy. And we look at those students and say it's clear that this student is going to contribute to the academic success of the institution and is going to do something great for our community, and we'd like to work with those students as well.
And Bob, I mean, when you hear something like this from a representative of Salisbury, how does this make you feel? Do you feel good that Salisbury has done a little bit or not enough? How would you like Salisbury to move?
Well, test optional is not just one thing. One of the things FairTest long criticizes is one-size-fits-all admissions policies. And we don't think that higher education institutions, which are very diverse in their missions and agendas, need to follow the same formula. What Salisbury is doing right now is right for Salisbury, and we applaud them. We also applaud schools that go further and are test optional for all applicants. And there are some that are only test optional. American University here in the district is test optional only if you apply by November 1. That's another step in the right direction. There's a spectrum of test optional admissions, and all of it is worthwhile.
Well, let's try to speak to some students who are watching today. What advice would you give to them? Let's say a student is in 10th or 11th grade. Should they take the SATs?
They should take the SAT either at a regular sitting or through a free practice test, which is available online or in books they can get in their library at their high school guidance office, and see how they do. If their scores are within the range of the institutions where they want to apply, they ought to then get on with their lives. Don't worry about test prep. Don't consume themselves with getting ready for the SAT. build the kind of rich resume by taking challenging classes, doing leadership and extracurricular activities, community service, that good admissions officers give much more credit to than how well you've boosted your score through the steroids of test prep.
Do you agree with that, Aaron?
I think it's great advice to look and say, well, what options can I have? I mean, I think Bob would agree with me that college is about options, and the college search is about options. So by taking tests, that gives you possibly some additional options, whether in terms of the consideration that you might get at certain institutions, or for particular scholarships that might require a standardized test score in order to qualify for that. So I think, again, what you want to do is make sure you maximize your options, do a little testing, see how it works for you. But again, it shouldn't be the driver of your academic process. It shouldn't be the driver of where you make your college choice. You should look for institutions that recognize you as a good fit for them, as well as you finding them a good fit for you. And you know, we do talk about that sense of fit. That's really, really important. And I think sometimes people discount that as not, you know, a logical or structured way to do it. But it really is a place, you're choosing a place where you want to be happy and you want to be successful, and you'll get the most out of your college experience if you can find that right sense of fit. And I think if you take the test and you give yourself that option, I think that's a great one to have. You might find that it comes in useful as colleges are looking at you as a whole person. And sometimes it won't be a big factor, and that's great. Again, you want to go for a fit, but it does give you more options, which I think is what it's
another
about.
Option to consider, of course, is taking the ACT, the Alternative College Admissions Test, which just about as many people take nationally now as the SAT, and every college in the country that requires test scores will take SAT or ACT. There are conversion tables. And if you're thinking about taking a test to go to college, you may want to take practice versions of both to see on which you do better. Mm-hmm. Some kids do better on the ACT, some do better on the SAT.
Well, but if a student's going to go through all of this, why wouldn't they take an SAT prep course or an ACT prep course?
Because if their score is already in the range of the colleges where they're needing to, where they intend to apply, there's no great value in boosting their score, and there's a tremendous amount of time and money that's wasted that could be better spent working in the community, working on their getting better grades in high school, which is the strongest predictor of all of how well you're doing in you'll do in college, something that admissions officers look at, and building a life rather than trying to get your numbers up by 10 or 20 or 50 points.
But if you don't mind me pressing you on this a little bit, I mean, what would happen if a student wants to go to a university where their scores aren't quite there yet? Then what's wrong with doing SAT prep?
Well, as I said, if your scores are within the range, there's no point in SAT prep. If you are aiming at a place that has higher score averages, and you need to look at the middle range, not the average score, to see if you're within it, then it makes sense to do ACT or SAT prep, not necessarily a high-end test prep course, the ones that cost $1,100 or the private tutors that cost $10,000 or $15,000, as they do on a number of East Coast cities, but to find the kind of prep that best meshes with the student's learning style and their parents' pocketbook. It could be a book which has a lot of practice tests in it. The strongest tool of all for getting better scores is taking practice tests. It may be doing something online, and it may be going to a private tutor if that's who you are and if it fits with your desires.
Well, both of you have used this word fit. And if I can ask you, Aaron, what does it mean to have the right fit with Salisbury? Who is your target student, and who's the student who comes to you? We're here in the District of Columbia.
Right.
Which students from Washington, D.C. tend to come to Salisbury? Which students from Maryland tend to come to Salisbury? And which students from outside of these two areas tend to come to Salisbury?
Absolutely. We talk about Salisbury as being a Maryland University of National Distinction. We look at, you know, reaching out to students within a broad area who we think would be a good fit for the institution. We're an institution that we're about 8,600 students. We're a mid-sized university, which there aren't a lot of them out there. There are lots of smaller places and lots of really large public institutions, but around 8,000 students is a pretty unique size, and I think a lot of students find that to be a good fit. They want to attend a place where they're going to be known, they're going to have access to faculty, they're going to be in small classes, but at the same time, they're going to feel like they're at a real university with real university-sized resources. And I think the student who typically finds a good fit with Salisbury is looking for things like small class sizes so they can have great interaction with faculty. I think they are looking for really kind of a high impact education where they're able to have a large hand in shaping what their academic experience is like, where they're able to take advantage of things like undergraduate research or experiential learning, really those engaged learning experiences that I think, make a college experience everything that it can be. So I think when you're out looking around at colleges and you're saying, you know, what do I think is a good fit for me? You need to do a little self-analysis and say, you know, where do I see myself? Do I see myself in a huge classroom and, you know, sitting in the back row? Or do I see myself actively engaged in the conversation that's going on in the classroom? And again, in shaping my education. And if that's what you're looking for, then I think Salisbury offers a great place to do that. Now, of course, it doesn't hurt. We have a beautiful campus. We're the only recognized Arboretum campus in the state of Maryland. And it also doesn't hurt. We're located pretty close to Ocean City, Maryland, which a lot of students like. But I think students tend to like Salisbury if they want a great, strong academic place that they can work closely with faculty in a strong community.
And how would you compare Salisbury with the University of Maryland College Park or Washington College?
Sure. Well, I think with College Park, certainly we overlap quite a bit in terms of students' applications. And you know, College Park is a great school, and part of that is just geography and the programs that they offer. But what I tend to find is that while students are out visiting around, they come to campus and they go to campus at College Park. And really the decision oftentimes comes to what kind of environment they really want to work in. And I think the student who is focused on having faculty interaction, on being able to do some of those, again, you know, kind of engaged learning pieces, the student who wants to sort of individualize their application more and be part of what feels like a real community, that student tends to pick Salisbury. I think those things are really central to what we do and who we think we're about, and they're a little harder to find at a really large institution. I think, you know, with a place like Washington College, again, you have private versus public. I think sometimes that decision comes down to cost, and most students find that public institutions can offer them an excellent value in terms of the education, but can do so at a lower cost. At the same time, I think, again, our unique size has some advantages in terms of offering students some big university resources in a small school feel.
Fair enough. And a follow-up question to that is, would you mind saying a word or two about how D.C. residents can benefit from this a tuition break?
Absolutely. That's a great point. For those who are in the district, the D.C. TAG program allows institutions like Salisbury to work with students from the district, and students utilizing that program can actually attend a school like Salisbury for the in-state price that a student from Maryland would do because of the reciprocal arrangement with D.C. So it's a great fit for students. We have a lot of students who come from D.C. Who find it a very welcoming place, who find it, you know, a great education. And, you know, we're far enough away to be a little bit distant from your family, but at the same time, to help you feel like, you know, it's not difficult to get back and forth when you want to. So that particular program makes it really easy for students to choose Salisbury as a place to be.
Fair enough. And if we can get back to the SAT thoughts for a moment, which schools are the SAT optional schools that are the big name SAT optional schools? And if you don't mind me asking you directly, why aren't some of the Ivy League schools test optional?
Overall, there are about 850 colleges and universities that do not require all or many applicants to submit ACT or SAT scores before admissions decisions are made, including Salisbury. Among that number, that's about a third of all four-year colleges in the country. Among that number, there are about 130 top-tier, as ranked by U.S. News and World Report, colleges and universities that are test optional. About a third of the nation's finest liberal arts colleges are test optional. A handful of major universities like Wake Forest and American University here in the district have test optional policies. Many fine smaller colleges like Washington College that Aaron just mentioned are test optional. There's a whole range. In terms of the Ivy League, which is 8 schools out of 2,700 in the United States, at least 2 are evaluating their admissions policies right now. Those types of schools are not ones which misuse the SAT. They get, or ACT, they get so many applicants with high scores and high grades and high leadership that none of those factors are weighed very heavily. So it would be great if a Harvard or a Yale were to go test optional, but the movement has continued to grow and expand. It's also true that 2 of the women's Ivy League schools, Mount Holyoke and Smith, are test optional.
You mean the Seven Sisters?
Seven Sisters, mm-hmm. Yes.
Steve, if I could add to that too, I think what you see is those institutions that are kind of leading and looking at test optional policies are those who really see as part of their mission this idea of looking at the whole student and trying to say, okay, we're really looking for that sense of fit, and we want to consider who, you know, the person is as a whole as we see what they're going to bring to our community. And so, you know, that's always been a part of the mission of the great liberal arts institutions, and I think you're finding more publics who are also saying, well, that's us too. We're really interested in that. You know, we aren't working with the volume to which, you know, we have to reduce some of those decisions to just quantitative pieces. We want to know what students can bring to us, you know, in multiple areas of our campus community. And so it's a little bit more of a natural fit for those institutions to reach out and say, I think this makes sense for us.
But couldn't a cynical person say, well, some colleges are doing SAT optional policies simply because they want more applications. And at $50 to $100 an application, that adds up, and therefore we want to encourage more people to apply.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's, you know, that's a fair charge that someone could level. I mean, I think we're really interested in finding the right applications, more so than more applications. I mean, as much as it's nice to have more applications, it also means more work to do. And so I think, you know, we're really looking and saying the test optional policy allows us to have some students within our pool that we might not otherwise have that we can then look at and say, this person could be a great match for us, a student who does something really outstanding at the local or the national level that allows us to give them a little bit additional consideration in the process, which I think is a great thing. I think we've seen too that it's allowed us to have a little bit more economic diversity within our applicant pool, which we think is a great benefit. And again, we go back and we see that the students that utilize the test optional policy, our studies have shown that they do very, very well, that they retain their GPAs are at the same level, and actually they tend to complete their courses a little bit faster than students who submit test scores to us. So we find it to be a very effective kind of match for us.
In fact, the research at test optional institutions across the board have found several things, that they do get more applications, they get a much more diverse pool of applicants, both in terms of race, gender, where background, rural versus urban, geography, where they come from, academic interests. It really improves the pool so that the college admissions officer has more interesting, talented folk to select from. So it's a win-win for those institutions. But many of the schools that have gone test optional were already highly selective, so it hasn't improved their rankings or anything like that. They were top schools then, and they're top schools now, and test optional.
Well, what would you consider a misuse of the SAT?
Well, there are some very clear misuses, even as specified by the owners of the SAT, the College Board, or the owners of the ACT. And one is using a test as a cutoff score, an absolute minimum requirement either for admission or for a scholarship. We're seeing fewer and fewer cutoff scores for admissions, though there are some out there. Those are violators of the test maker's own standards, and they should be castigated for that. Many scholarship programs run by private institutions and state agencies have cutoff scores for scholarships. And that recently, the National Association for College Admissions Counseling, the big association of high school guidance counselors and college admissions officers, said that too is a violation of appropriate admissions practices.
Well, I'm with you on that, but I guess I'm wondering, let's say somebody set up a private scholarship in the middle of Iowa. We just had some people from Iowa on the show, uh-huh. Right? And they came in, and let's say somebody sets up a private scholarship fund, and they don't know anything about admissions. They haven't been involved in the world of education for years, mm-hmm. And it's a company, and they say, we want to give a scholarship to our employees. And they have to come up with some cutoff. And so they say, why don't we just do an SAT or an ACT cutoff?
Well, first of all, they don't have to come up with a cutoff. The largest scholarship agency in the country, which is called the Citizen Scholarship Foundation of America, doesn't use test scores in that manner. Yes, but what you're describing is very common. What happens, however, when you set a cutoff score for scholarship is that you assure that the winners of those scholarships are the kids whose parents can pay for the most test coaching. Because test coaching does increase scores, parents buy their kids another leg up, and so you find test score-based scholarships with high cutoffs going to the wealthiest kids in our country, not the ones who need the money to go to college, and that becomes a pool that is very skewed demographically to upper-income whites and Asians, excluding African-Americans, Latinos, new Asian immigrants, and whatnot.
Do you find that true to be in Salisbury as well?
Well, you know, I was just thinking when you gave that example of, you know, somebody trying to establish a scholarship, I mean, certainly I think that the challenge that you get into is anytime you try to use the test score as a shortcut, which I think, you know, it's convenient to do that, but it's not always the, you know, the best, most accurate way to go about it. And I would think if you were, let's say someone wanted to make a scholarship fund and they wanted to partner with a particular institution like Salisbury to be able to do that, I would encourage that person to talk to the institution and say, what is it that makes students most successful at Salisbury? And I can guarantee you that every good admissions office will have done research on what students are successful with them and which ones are not, which students retain and make it on to graduation and, you know, go on successfully and which ones don't. And for them to be able to get a little bit of feedback and, you know, maybe they say something like, you know, what we find is that the students who take the most rigorous coursework, those are the students that tend to be successful. So, you know, if you'll work with us, we'll come up with a measure to help you figure out which students are taking the most rigorous coursework, just as an example. But again, I think if a donor would talk to an admissions office and say, what makes a student successful here? I think they would get a great answer that they would be able to use, again, as a cutoff criteria, but might be more appropriate to that particular place.
Fair enough. Well, let's play this out a little bit. I know that you have a big program in terms of children's literature. So let's assume that I'm a donor and I want to come up with some sort of scholarship fund to encourage kids to write children's literature,
sure,
or older kids to write literature for younger kids. How would one craft that without the SAT or ACT? What's the mechanism by which we judge whether or not the writing is good? How do we determine that?
Well, what I would typically do is, and probably advise that person to do, is to work again, you know, with the admissions offices and say, how do you look at a student in a holistic way? What are the factors that are most important to you? So again, we might sit down with that donor and say, what we find is that students going into that program typically have this kind of background. They've taken these kinds of classes. They have this type of GPA, the students that are the most successful. And maybe they've already demonstrated some kind of interest or ability in that area. They've demonstrated some kind of commitment to the field of children's literature or to working with children. And so why don't you allow us to, you know, push students in your direction who, in our normal review process, we can then tag and say, this is a student who makes sense for this type of scholarship because of the background, because of the classes they take, and because they have an obvious passion for this field. I think, you know, in the long run, that would make the donor happier to know that their funding went to somebody who actually really wants to do this and, you know, feels like this is their calling. I think, again, everybody kind of wins by working through the processes that the university may already have in place or tweaking them slightly.
Fair enough. And in terms of essays, how do you evaluate essays vis-a-vis the testing options that are available to students?
Essays are important, I think, you know, really for two reasons. First, I think, you know, we all would agree that there are not a lot of people who are great writers out there, not as many as we need to have out there. And I think businesses tell that to colleges all the time, you know, make sure that your students get great writing opportunities. And so we look first and foremost and say, you know, is the student a great writer? Do they have a good command of the English language? You know, can they express themselves well? Do they know what an essay, you know, looks like? That's kind of step one. But I think really beyond that, the essay is the student's opportunity to tell us who they really are. Beyond just the grades that we look at or the classes they've chosen or a test score, it's the student's opportunity to say, this is who I am, this is what I'm passionate about, and here's how I think I could impact your particular academic community. And that's important to us. We want to know that a student is interested and has thought about, you know, the institution as a potential fit. We want to see that the student is capable of demonstrating something rather than just, you know, telling us about themselves. So we think, you know, the NSA can be a great indicator, especially if those really top students, they're the ones that are able to, you know, express themselves and talk about their drive to succeed at the college level. So, you know, an essay can, it may or may not be the first thing that we look at, but it can make or break, you know, a student's application process.
And will you give some extra money to students who have particularly strong applications?
That would be, you know, one of those students that we talked about that, you know, we might look at another factor and say, oh, okay, this is a reason to give a student additional consideration in here. Now, sometimes those essays come from students who, you know, have everything else in their academic portfolio is also very strong, and so it's very easy to say, well, it makes sense that this student have a great essay. It looks like they have a great background and, you know, good scores and great classes and all those kinds of things. But occasionally we have students who are outstanding. I think that happens particularly in our honors program. I've spoken, you know, a lot with our honors program director, and he said, you know, sometimes that essay is really what stands out and says, this is a student that we want in our program.
Fair enough. We're going to be out of time in just a few minutes, but I know, Bob, you are itching to plug your book, and it's a good book, and I like what I know about it. So if you don't mind saying a word or two about your book.
Well, this is a book we actually attributed a chapter to. It's called SAT Wars, The Case for Test Optional College Admissions. Grew out of a conference at Wake Forest University soon after they became test optional a couple of years ago. And it summarizes the arguments for why schools should be test optional and how it better serves society and applicants.
And in terms of society, how do other societies handle this?
Well, the U.S. is unique in having these private sector run standardized admissions tests, the SAT and ACT. Some other countries have the government runs a college admissions test, like China. Other countries, like Canada, don't have a nationwide standardized admissions test. Some schools use SAT or SAT2 subject tests for admissions in Canada. Others don't. So it really depends. One of the things we've noticed recently is a number of American schools overseas, like the American College of Rome or American College in Paris, those are moving towards test optional admissions now.
Do you have any objection to measuring aptitude in a subject?
No objection to it, but again, a better measure of how well you've done in a subject is your grade in that subject, particularly in a subject like a rigorous one, like an advanced placement class, which does have a standardized exam as part of it. The SAT subject tests, which are only required by about 36 colleges in the country, are not particularly good measures. They're no better than the SAT or ACT.
And you feel confident in terms of the AP results?
The AP results, as one factor, are a measure of college equivalent mastery. They're geared to the curriculum that are given in college, and the scores are supposed to be equivalent to what you get in a college grade.
Fair enough. I think we're going to have to leave it at that. I want to thank you both for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Our pleasure.
Thank you. If you would like additional information about Salisbury University or the National Center for Fair and Open Testing, please visit salisbury.edu or fairtest.org. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at highereducationtoday@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Stephen Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.